closing the gap. We'll talk a little bit about which gap or gaps we're referring to, and how gender and prestige are linked in science.
We'll begin with some motivations, and then move on to what the patterns, the description of, tell us about what's going on in science and perhaps in society, and then come back to what we need. And this is where it's all of us, right? We're all leading the teaching, especially.
And so just for the goals that we're working with today, just to raise your awareness of certain issues, and then maybe arm you with what you can do about it. So the morning was very informational, I think, for all of you, and the afternoon, including this session, we want it to be more action-driven, and we want you guys to participate, so feel free to interject, and there will be some time for discussions. Yep, come in. One of the things that we want to talk about is how representation of women and minorities is very skewed in STEM fields. So in the biological sciences, actually very close to 50%, maybe even a little over, but in just about every other field, women are very underrepresented. So the first gap that we want to discuss is just the representation gap, the presence of women in these fields. Second gap is a wage gap. So who here has heard of the wage gap? What do you guys know about it? Like, what do you think it is?
Just the cost of 70 cents on the dollar.
Yeah.
It's more complicated.
Yeah, like this thing, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. So the wage gap for STEM is a little bit different. It's actually a little bit better than the 70 cents to the dollar in STEM fields. Women tend to earn about 86 cents for every dollar earned by men. But that's an average. So if you look at different fields within STEM, those wage gaps are pretty different. And we'll maybe talk a little bit about why that might be. One statistic that really stood out to me is that as women enter STEM fields or traditionally male-dominated fields, the wages of that whole field go down. So maybe the wage gap doesn't change, but everyone in the field gets paid less. So for every 10% raise in the proportion of women that you get a decrease anywhere from 0.5 to 5% wages. And then the decrease in pay is accompanied with a decrease in prestige. So one study looked at ranking of prestigious universities and degree granting programs, and the number of women that were enrolled and graduated from the most prestigious and all the way down to the least prestigious. So it turns out that the top half of most prestigious programs severely lacks women in degree granting.
And in all of these studies, the social scientists leading the analyses that I've cited here and will be cited, and they've controlled for all the first things that might come to your mind to explain these patterns. They've accounted for sort of age and stage and all sorts of things. Mm-hmm. So the gap persists even when controlled for.
So the other thing that's the American Psychological Association actually has a statement that says that they believe that the prestige of their field decreased before women started entering, but that's been a contentious topic, to say the least. Most of the literature has run analyses both ways to look at which is the dependent variable, and it's pretty robust, the finding that when women enter, that's when the pain prestige goes down. So I mentioned psychology, but there are a few sort of case studies that we can look at within science and medicine. In biology, I told you that women are around 50%, maybe even more, but the wages overall of the field of biology have decreased 18% since women have entered, since women became more than 30% of the biology field. And similar things have happened in medicine too, in pediatrics and OBGYN, and later in family medicine, which were the fields that women were first allowed into, those experience the least pay amongst physicians and also the least prestige. But they're just as are working and just, you know, they're trained just as much. They still have to go to medical school.
Residency is just as long.
It's just as long. So, we look outside of STEM, and we look at, for example,
Excuse me, could you move in like one row and then maybe the rest of the people? Sorry, thank you.
If we compare fields like IT managers and HR managers that have similar levels of education and experience and hours worked, but one is mostly male, the IT managers, and one is mostly female, HR managers, there's actually a pretty striking wage difference in similar type of work done by similarly educated people. And the same is true, for example, with janitorial or housekeeping staff. Janitorial staff is paid 22% more than housekeeping staff. Controlling for all the things that you might think of. And then one really interesting example is with parks and recreation and camp leaders. Those types of jobs used to be mostly male, and then they switched from between the 50s and now to being mostly female. And they experienced, some estimates are between 43 and 57% decrease in wages. Controlling for inflation. We look at the converse situation. We look at the field of computer programming, which used to be a menial job done by women. Now it's mostly male. This field has actually seen an explosion in pay and prestige, so now it's like the highest paid field. And then if you look at physicians in Russia, are mostly female, and they have to go through all the same training that physicians in the US do, but they're paid something like the equivalent of $12,000 a year, which is a full order of magnitude below what physicians are paid here. And that's often chalked up to being seen as like a woman's job because it's a caregiver role. So that's where that bias might come from. And then a converse example in the field of nursing is just that, which is a female-dominated field. Male nurses in a female-dominated field make $5,000 more per year.
How much more, sorry?
$5,000. So, I don't know, does anyone want to discuss any of these fields, any experiences, or anything that you might know about?
I guess I'm just curious, like, about the nursing one. Like, I feel like these are, like, employees at a hospital that are all kind of, you know, employed under a similar contract or something.
Yeah.
So, like, whose job is it to say that the male nurse makes $5,000 more? Like, how does that happen, I guess?
Yeah, so,
I
do want to talk about hiring practices and salary negotiation. Should there be salary negotiation? To not have transparency when we talk about salaries and who gets paid what. Maybe so that they can get away with paying certain people less. And I've not really been known about, because salary is not something that you talk about day to day in your job. But yeah, I don't know exactly, like, who is setting these numbers, but
I think hiring salaries are probably the same, but then there are promotions. And then that's where the differences, I think, come from. A few years down the road, when maybe you have to take care of a child, or you have, and then suddenly you're putting less hours, and then the gap is getting larger with the experience.
It'd be interesting to know about the applicant pool as well, right? Because if you have different positions listed starting salaries, there might be some self-selection potentially.
Yeah.
Male nurses won't even apply to it's
okay.
Just by analogy with how things work, for example, the admission to graduate school.
Just on that same note, I wonder how much do you think that the salary gap like this is a problem because of the hiring policies and how the higher administration decides to pay different people, or whether there is a problem earlier in that situation in which women feel like they are already at a disadvantage in situations, or anyone in a minority, and it's so are less assertive and less forthright. And you know, when people, you know, often people ask you, what is your salary expectation? And is there, it'd be interesting to know if there's a systematic undervaluation that women have in that situation. So they never, you know, and if someone says that you can pay me this much as opposed to, you know, $5,000 or $10,000 more, they're obviously gonna to do that.
So I swear I did not plan this question. but I think that was a great segue into something that I want to talk about, which is valuing women's work and how women value their own work and other women's work versus the valuation of men's work. I don't know, what do you guys think? I'm going to tell you about that. yeah, women do undervalue their own work compared to men's work, and I do think that that's part of the problem.
I'm wondering whether this pattern of increasing salary in general, is that associated or correlated with who is in the top positions of the field?
I didn't like that either. exactly. So the leadership gap, that's what you're referring to. Even though women make up more and more of percentages and proportions of these fields, they're not, those numbers at the highest levels of leadership, they're not raising at all. They're just plateaued right around 17% for most fields.
Do you think this is a transient phenomenon? We're heading to something better, and if we had enough data for the next 10 or 20 years, we would see something closer to equality?
I hope it happens sooner than that, because...
Well, and along that line, it was 20 years ago, it was said, this is going to be a transient phenomenon. Mm-hmm. And 20 years is enough to see people go through all the stages. And 20 years ago it was said, oh, the women are going to get all the jobs because they're now being given special treatment, and so there won't be any jobs left over for the men. And the proportions haven't changed that much. So I think it would be a great idea.
These numbers right around 17%, all the ones I'm about to show you, they haven't changed since the 70s.
Issues being discussed exactly 20 years ago?
That's around when it started being discussed. Mm-hmm. A lot of the big pushes started happening. So that's why I mentioned that.
I know the example of the Russian ones with the in the medical profession, because I remember going to a meeting in 1973, and there was a switch over just between the Russian physicians being dominated by males, and then just almost being dominated by females, and the salaries just plummeted across the field very, very fast. And this was an issue in just 1973.
So it's now 2017. Here we are.
You mentioned that the salaries dropped by something like 18%. Biology across the board after women started entering the field in much larger numbers than they were before. I'm curious how much of that is attributable to the entry of women into the field with respect to the gendering of a field or whatever you might want to call it, in addition to other issues like the general expansion of the workforce in biology, the general expansion of grants and projects given by the federal government, and the much greater labor competition that you would see as a result.
Yes.
With people working much more, much longer hours for much lower pay across the board, just to be able to get their projects off the ground.
No, that's an excellent point, and I should have clarified, thanks for bringing it up, I should have clarified it sooner, but that number is after accounting for all of that.
Oh, I see.
Yeah, so it's what's left that's unexplained by all of the parameters that you just mentioned. Yeah, so unfortunately it's a real 18. The number of women in the top leadership positions, not just in STEM, but across the board, Fortune 500 companies, just even on the boards of the Fortune 500 companies or as CEOs, other senior management, equity partners, whatever your favorite top leadership position is, it's probably not more than 20%.
This is a question that deals with the leadership gap to some extent, but also just in academia in general, folks who move around a fair amount tend to earn more because they're simply rising each time. People who are hired into leadership positions are often hired from outside and the like. To what extent is there an effect of this and the relative motility of women from job to job, or is this not a gender factor?
I think it might be, but I don't think it's reflected in this number because this is more of a snapshot. So over time at any given point...
But these are the people who will have moved in some cases to go to a larger salary.
Yeah, I think the gender aspect of that is actually that women tend to not move as much. So they tend to be more geographically.
Okay, so if anything, it contributes.
Yes. If anything. And then, so representation not only at the highest levels, at the highest leadership levels, but just in the number of op-eds, which seems to be not more than 20%. TV panels, when you have panels of experts, tends to be just about 10 or 20% women, sort of like the token female who's on there just so no one writes into the news, the news station saying, it's totally biased, yeah, there's women, so they'll throw a woman. And in Congress, that number's been stuck at 15%. So, what's the problem, right? So, why is this a problem? Maybe women just want to stay. Maybe they don't want to be leaders, or they don't want to be paid equally. Does anyone have any thoughts on that?
Well, from the point of view of the society as a whole, it seems like a tremendous waste of talent. If in science, you're only selecting from half the population officially, then you're probably throwing out a lot of good scientists.
I'm not planning. Yeah, no, that's... Well, that's what I'm talking about. Yeah, exactly. Everyone benefits.
I'd also sort of say the role model effect. If you don't have enough women in leadership levels, like same thing in minorities in leadership levels, then there's an additional barrier to entering the field in the first place.
Absolutely, and I think the use of the word representation throughout the talk is reflective of that. So we want to have good representation. We want to see yourself in tenure.
How does one flesh out that argument that we want women to be equally represented in the workforce because we want a diversity of opinions, perspectives, experiences, etc. I guess we're making a pass that somebody might question. Are you making the assumption that women are therefore different? They have different opinions. They have different. How would you flesh that out a little bit so that it's a little bit more convincing to somebody who might object and say, well, you're just admitting that women might have...
Women are different.
They have a different... Not necessarily so. I mean, many women think very much like men. Right?
Yeah.
So, in our discussions
beforehand, we were trying to peel those apart as well. We were trying to say that if, for example, as in biology, if you'll, I represent, undergraduate women, 70% of the majors in biology, graduate women, maybe 50-50 or so, and yet we see this persistent 15-20% at the most senior levels in biology, even 20-30 years after the women were getting their degrees in biology, right? We want to separate the career opportunities or the excellence of science ideas. Why rule out a huge fraction of the excellent scientists by having this cap at the seniority to which they can aspire as scientists, right? So the kind of, just let's have science represent the trainees of science, as it were. But then there's this other issue of diversity at the table, diversity of all sorts at the table, in principle should improve our science if we really want to brainstorm all the alternative hypotheses and really try to not be entrenched in dogmas and think of new ways of interpreting patterns or something, right? In principle, diversity of ideas, wherever they're coming from, ought to be good for science too. So we wanted to sort of peel those two things apart, but you're right to
But I don't think you answered her point. So.
Oh, yes, so I totally agree that we're not saying women necessarily bring a different viewpoint. Sorry, that all of my answer was because I agree that women are not necessarily any different from men in the perspective they bring to the table in science. Likewise, any other minority group might or might not bring a different alternative hypothesis to the table, but they might.
So I think what gets lost in that, and part of what you're addressing, is whether women somehow are intrinsically and from the beginning different, and whether they're a single thing. And I think that we know that's not the case, and science and academia are themselves gendered, and so many of the first women who were in science and in academia better fit the male mold and the mode that those who were going to take care of children would be the women. And there's no need in academia to have child care, to have time off, and so on. And so, yes, that does select out. It's a sieve on only a certain subset of women. And so I think that gets caught up in
That's definitely part of it, yeah.
Mm-hmm. I would also add to that diversity, it's, I think, diversity in males, diversity in females, diversity in different countries. What we're seeing right now is cutting down on diversity. So diversity bringing as diverse as you can possibly get is always very revealing, rewarding, and it stimulates creativity and different ideas. So I think the diversity is both in males and females. You know, there are huge diversity, well, there's as much diversity in females as there is in males.
I think something that we've kind of been touching upon is this idea that a lot of women, I think, when they grow up are taught is that in order to succeed in a STEM position, they have to embrace characteristics that are generally considered to be pretty masculine characteristics. And I think one of the things that our culture needs to start emphasizing is that a woman can be a woman in STEM with also characteristics that are thought of more as feminine, and inherently that brings a diversity to the table that I think oftentimes women are maybe taught to repress, even though those traits are the ones that do enhance their ability at the leadership table. And those typically like more feminine characteristics that our culture considers more feminine are often kind of downplayed in female leadership roles, even though they should maybe be enhanced to really bring that diversity to the table that people need.
I completely agree, and I think it might even contribute to a bit of self-selection bias. So if you look at sort of who's been, famous female scientists in the past and you don't look like her, you don't dress like her, those are not your characteristics, and you're uncomfortable fitting yourself into that mold, then that just might not be a path that you choose to go down. I'm just gonna bond into what we can do. So in order to work to achieve gender and racial, I think we were touching a bit on other types of diversity also, mm-hmm. gender and race parity. We want to work to create a society that values women's work, and also to do that, we need to change kind of this culture of this undervaluing. So it's not an easy task to change a very established entrenched culture, but we're going to try and do it in the next. So, but how can we do this? If you look at people who talk about the wage gap, the National Women's Law Center is just one of many organizations that tries to address this. They have lists and lists of the things that we can do or that they want to do, things that should be done in order to achieve this gender parity. But for us, actually, how we can do this, I want to share with you something called a social ecological model to affect cultural change. And this is an example from the CDC. This model has been adapted to try and change cultures about healthcare, and this specific one is to try and change cultures about colorectal cancer. So people don't want to get colonoscopies. It's not pleasant, it's not fun, but they are really, really effective in preventing colorectal cancer. So the CDC took an approach that engaged the individual, but all the way up in through a policy in order to hit every single one of these levels to try change the culture around colonoscopies, basically, is what this is about. So I would like us to try and do a similar thing and come up with some real concrete actions and things that you and I can do in order to change the culture around gender and prestige in STEM medicine. So.
With actions ranging across these different scales, right? The things we can do immediately ourselves in our day-to-day scaling up through how we can actually change the organizations for persons and individuals. So we've given the room size, should we?
Yeah.
Keep it as one.
Yeah, let's just stay in one big group. Does anyone have any ideas on how to meaningfully engage in issues? This is also broader than just this issue.
Well, one is simply storytelling about the roles that women have had. For example, my mother basically taught me everything about the scientific method and the like that I know about, despite the fact that she was hard to tell whether forced or by choice, into the position of being a baby machine to manufacture a large number of siblings. And so she had no professional life at all, but she had been a scientist in college, and she just taught us how to ask questions, how to get answers by comparative and experimental methods and the like. There's no question that she was a scientific influence well before any other teachers.
Okay.
And just that, piling up those kinds of narratives take you from the individual to the interpersonal level.
I was just gonna add to that, even within, not necessarily like a family story, but within our own groups here at the university, just recognizing and praising and expressing, you know, actually voicing the value that we can assign to women's work, just to sort of make women themselves actually value their work more, but also to draw attention to people who might be in supervisory roles that someone else is contributing in a way that's meaningful.
Yeah, no, that's absolutely, and well said.
So, kind of, I'm sorry, I have a cold, so I can't speak that loudly, but on an individual level, I think it might help us to kind of go through the process of recognizing and facing our own biases, including as women against other women, because we all have them. And I really hate to admit this, but I'm going to put my head on the chopping block to hopefully for the greater good. But I was just at a conference and I found myself having fleeting thoughts about sort of taking one woman that I was working with a little less seriously because she was because of how she was dressed, despite the fact that I was also working with men who were like dressed in old faded t-shirts and like sneakers, and I wasn't judging them for how they were dressed. And so I think it's helpful for us to kind of face those hard truths and recognize where our own biases lie and to work to correct them.
I mean, I think that's the best thing that you could have done is actually recognize it yourself when it's happening with yourself. Try and continue to do that, hopefully, at this point. Yeah, it's hard to unlearn these things, right?
Yeah.
They've been conditioned into us as a society for ever.
The thing you just said about it's hard for us to unlearn these things, I think, is so important, because there's long been a recognition, and the literature is only increasing now, that so much gets established in the first few years of life. By the time people start first grade, even, most of these biases are already in. And so I think one of the questions is, how can we take that and not keep waiting till another generation comes up and has to face that in themselves? And I think that's really tough. Things like the parental leave that Princeton has for both fathers and mothers, and starting out, can we help pay child care workers, not call it women's work, but things that affect young children? What can we do to change right now how they're going to come up, at the same time that we address what we're stuck with as adults in ourselves? And that seems really important, because if we don't begin to attack at the level of young children, in some ways it's a very self-defeating, kind of thing.
Yeah, I definitely agree with that, and that I think we ask someone on the street, what do you think when you think of a scientist? You have this one archetype of a scientist, and I guess perpetuated throughout the generations. And you get taught that as a child, and you have this one image. And the thing is that we need to be thinking about, okay, about women's other women scientists, and be actively showing young children, especially young girls, that they can be scientists as well, that it's not just boys' work or a boy's dream, right, to be a scientist, that it could also be a real career for girls as well. So you can start looking at a more personal level. You can maybe perhaps do it as a parent, just teaching your daughter or other girls that they can be scientists, or maybe even going to like elementary schools or pre-K, showing that excitement of science and trying to show them that, okay, both boys and girls can be scientists.
What do you think about what we should teach our sons?
All your peers can be scientists as well, right?
Yeah.
That they should not be, they should not think of themselves as being better than a female scientist, right?
But
that
we need to also encourage their sisters. Or
yeah, encourage them, right?
I just want to bring it from the individual out a little bit more. So I think we had a really good discussion on what we can do internally, reflecting and sort of observing these biases in ourselves. But also, I think you touched on it a little bit. What can we do that involves our interpersonal and organizational levels? So besides like saying out loud, like, hey, good job, or other ways of valuing people's work.
So I think something that I've personally noticed a lot, and that I think there's a lot of like work that has shown this, is sort of the lack of inclusion of average women scientists, like excellent women scientists, or like especially when you're grading, for example, like I've noticed like all the classes I've graded, the women mostly fall in the top like 15%. Like there's not as many average women. And I was physics and undergrad and engineering now. And yeah, in all the classes I've seen sort of this trend that it's sort of like, where are all the average women? And so I don't know if that's something that has to happen at elementary, middle school, or what level, but maybe that's something like teacher education and primary and secondary school needs to focus on. It's like, if you're average, you can still go and like have careers in this field.
Average is good.
Yes.
Yeah, I would say that, moving on, what's been said previously, I'd see sort of the promotion of women and other disadvantaged groups into the top leadership ranks, as well as the reshaping of things like childcare policies for employees and stuff like that, as a very broadly based holistic investment in a human resource, because I'm not sure that necessarily everyone is going to be convinced by the more emotional arguments in favor of diversity. Whereas if you cast it as a more impersonal, if you want to call it, issue of investing in their skills and stuff like that, A, by having more women or other disadvantaged minorities and stuff like that at the top, you no longer have to worry about things like programs for encouraging girls and children of disadvantaged minorities to code or to go into science or stuff like that, because they already have those pipelines that they can see will lead to the top much more so than they do today. And likewise, by allowing for more flexible childcare policies and stuff like that, those investments are being made by the parents into the get-go. And these parents will be, presumably, you know, at the top of scientific institutions or business institutions or wherever you want to look at it.
So we're going to write some letters to
these
folks.
I'm sorry?
I want to talk a little bit also about concrete actions that we can take. And I agree with all the points that are being raised, but I think it's easier to say, like, yeah, this is a thing that should happen, versus let's do it. So how would you go about effecting this change?
We have two things to talk about. I did my PhD very recently at the University of Toronto in the computer science department. Well, they have a regular bi-weekly meeting of women in computer science. And many of these meetings are dedicated to just inviting a professor, a female professor, who just tells her story. I grew up there, I went into bachelor there, then I got depressed, then I went back to the industry, then I wanted to change my field completely, then I went back, then I got married, then I had kids. Then I went, and what's important about that? That you see them as people. You don't think of them as these superheroes that you can't be, but you see they are people and they went through the same path that you might go through. And you think, okay, maybe I can be this person. Maybe I can face these challenges and actually reach this goal, even though I am me, or that they are all me, as a matter of fact. And the other thing, so I really miss that. I miss having this. The disadvantage of that is that it was only open to female students. So yeah, it was very good. It gave a very secure environment to ask questions, to debate, have kids, etc. On the other hand, it didn't make the female students feel visible to the entire community, which is also And now organizing the first workshop for women in natural language processing, the field in computer science, that actually had more female, higher female percentages in the past, and it's dropping. So as opposed to getting better, it's getting worse and worse and worse.
It's like computer programming.
It's from 50%, from around 50%, it's now 15. So it's really decreasing. And this is exactly our goal, to bring lots of diversity into this workshop, to co-locate it with the main conference of the field, and to make the research of underrepresented minorities, not just women, visible to the community. So, and also to provide some travel subsidies so that people who are represented in and by that increase the number of people participating in the number of something.
I think it's great that you're doing that. I think it's one of the things that we should think about in terms of what are our concrete actions. So starting, you know, having a seminar speaker or inviting a speaker or even a series of speakers is exactly the kind of thing that moves towards changing the culture.
But I think the group meetings have been very detrimental, open to undergrads who could sit there and network with more and more senior people. So starting from senior and then going to PhDs and master students and professors and just create a community. That's one thing that is here.
I think those are great ways of, in a sense, maximizing the impact of the 15% that we have right now, right? Maximizing the impact of the current role models, even though there are still a proportion that is does not reflect the numbers earlier in the pipeline. So by humanizing the role models, that makes it seem more accessible, right, to your average junior scientist. And then also by making sure that men and women, or across the board, all the practicing scientists know about that person, not just sort of special interest groups or something, right? I think those are excellent ways to maximize use of the 15%. And maybe that's exactly the kind of thing that will eventually nudge 15% up, right? I mean, it may be that it's that kind of intermediate scale action that will systematize the appreciation of these voices in the table in science. So you may have really, I think, gotten onto something that could help break the stasis.
I have two boys, and I'm a scientist. And, well, at least the older one knows, he's six. And when they asked me about some things, he said, no, only boys do. And they said, but who has this computer in the house? I said, only mommy. Who drives the car? Well, both mommy and daddy. Who build furniture? Only mommy. He said, so why do only men do that? It comes from the education system,
yeah.
And the TV, unfortunately.
Yeah. So the other thing I think if you want to be truly radical is to more follow the Scandinavian way, where they have 2 years. Parental leave. 1 year must be taken by the male father, 1 year by the mother. And so they grow up knowing that, you know, the male and female are equally capable of doing all these things, from looking after to changing light bulbs to mending cars. So that starts right, you know, right at the bottom.
Yeah, I think your point about paternity leave is excellent. Princeton is good in that they do offer that.
Yeah, I actually am quite proud of having a big role in having an equal for making it equal for male and female. So when they first started, they just wanted to do it for females. Mm-hmm. And now they do it for male and female. But really, it's not enough. It's only 3 weeks or something.
Could be extended to 4 or 6.
but this 2 years is really great, because the child is very conscious of those parents.
But
yeah.
It's 3 weeks, right?
Huh?
It's 3 weeks for fathers, so a lot of the men who are taking paternity leave will also hoard their vacation time and take longer, so that they can take as long as the wife or just help the spouse with the mother.
Was it mandatory 1 year leave, or was it optional?
When it was being discussed, was when the request arrived in Princeton, and it was being discussed, it just No, I'm sorry, what it was is coming up in January. It was whether women could get an extra year for 10 years if they had a baby. And my point was, it should be both a male and a female, because otherwise you're just exacerbating the role that it's a woman who looks after the child. It should be both. Sorry, that was my role. But it also was tied into this maternity leave, and I thought that 3 weeks was just absolutely a mean, 3 weeks is nothing to make up a baseline.
The first 19 years in August.
That's good.
This is an awesome discussion. I don't want to, we just have about 5 to 7 minutes. Yeah, I
was just going to say that, I guess in relation to that, I think the current, like, model of working in which you just spend as many hours like even in labs or like, I don't know, even in medical working, you do like in three, for example, is like, I think it's something that's only sustainable within the whole framework of like having a personal life plus work. If you have, I think it's under the assumption that there's someone dedicated to maintaining like a household. And so in that sense, I think that kind of dichotomy has to change, because then like under traditional, under traditional just like social norms, like it's always the woman that has to make the choice of which one am I going to prioritize. But I think if we can shift that kind of work ethic norm, where it's like one that's more of balance and one where you don't have to choose. And that also, I mean, it's kind of like something that individuals have to make a decision in, which then like affects like cultures and departments. And,
so mentioning her story with her son, so like as individuals we can change their biases or something, but like most of the biases come from education and TV. So what as an individual can we do in relation
to that? The ways in which we can affect, like we can reach broader audiences, I think today is the best time that we could be trying to solve this problem because of social media. We can post articles on social media, that address this issue, right? We can spread awareness further than just our little bubble. We can petition universities for extending the paternity leave, for example. What else can we do?
We have a really good science education department at Princeton Plasma Physics Lab, which is where I'm a graduate student. And I think, unfortunately, one of the reasons for that is that plasma physics is the least women-populated field of physics, with about 7%. Women in the entire field, so we have a really bad track record. But I really feel like that as far as actions go on like these organizational and community levels that you're talking about, it really helps to jump onto something that's already started. So you're talking about this University of Toronto like club that already existed. You know, it's really good to start from something that is already happening and going further. But then like out of the science ed department at PBPL, there's a QWIP, the Women in Physics Conference that happens each year, that it seems to me is a really good combination of both like kind of these issues of like paternity and maternity leave, and like they discuss what is it like to have kids in grad school, but also a lot of the day is just about here a bunch of women scientists that are doing good work. And so you see like not just experts, but you know, more like just people in everyday life of science, and you see that they're doing well, they're a woman too, and I could be like that. So I think this is like, there are things like this happening now.
Just trying to put all these things together. What I think is always a problem is that all this stuff, as somebody mentioned, you learn while you're growing, right? Depending on your family, how they raise you, etc. Some people are very conscious about it, and then you join those groups, like for example, the one you're talking in Toronto, right? Before, in my previous institute, was the same. We had a group when we would meet every other month, and we would discuss something, but only people who are already aware of these unconscious biases that you were mentioning before, they will join those groups. 90% of the population won't. You try to be inclusive, we try to invite males and everyone, and they never join. Also, a lot of women were like, oh, I don't want to join a women's club. They saw it like that, right? So I'm wondering, I'm a postdoc here, so I'm not familiar with grad student or undergrad programs, but I'm wondering if it is possible, or at least is, or if it already exists, like a mandatory course, because it's a matter for education. The same way you are educated in math to be able to sum and multiply, you should be educated in equality, right? And how you perceive that. I mean, I've been going through videos, you Google that, and they have pretty cool tests about unconscious biases. Mm-hmm. And I'm pretty sure everyone in this room is going to fail. All of us, we are unconsciously biased against women, because that's the culture we grew up with, right? So I don't know how is it that handled here in terms of other courses that students study, or
I think answer from the biology side. First of all, I should say that thus far most of the efforts are at the departmental scale, which means They can be tailored to the needs of that department, but it also means there's huge heterogeneity in whether departments are doing it at all, how powerful the voice is to do that. In the biology departments, we have some initiatives along those lines in terms of having the groups, but as for more formal education of people with unconscious bias, that will be left to the departments. Right now, the university, the provost's office, is interested in developing that kind of curriculum, but it's very early days. I've just been on sabbatical and probably missed the most recent developments, but when I left in August, the provost's office was very actively figuring out what that curriculum needed to be, how to roll it out, because how it's presented is really important, right? So I think we might be coming to a time where there's more central leadership on that sort of thing, but we're not quite there yet. And in the meantime, department scale action is what I would recommend. So for people who don't know who to write a letter to in the first instance, department chairs might be a good starting point, because that is the unit of organization and autonomy on this campus. So
yeah, I would even encourage you to reach out directly to, I don't know if there's a committee already on this, but if there isn't,
the provost, that's true as well. One thing I think neglected to say at the beginning is that we would be happy to send these slides updated to reflect the conversation to anyone who would like to receive them, and we should put exactly this, the state of play, at both the central level and department levels, to the best of our ability, we'll update that as well. So, yes, we have the sign-in sheets. Anyone who is interested in receiving slides but doesn't have their email address on these sign-in sheets, please correct that now. Do we need to
Skip around? It's going to be per room, per...
We can co-op this. We can take pictures of this and
yeah,
submit it to the central board. She's one of the head honchos.
So,
okay.
That's it. That's all I had. These are just the references. But I think what's probably really useful right now is putting email letters back up. You want the slides or the updated version of the slides.
Or further ideas or anything. It's great to have this event and just hear some momentum in the conversation. Thank you very much.